We're glad you are here, and we hope that all of you had a chance to either dive into your homework or at least get into Exodus 6, 7, and 8. Read those three chapters at some point during this week so you're ready to kind of talk about what we're going to dive into tonight. But tonight, I am super excited, Tammy, because while I love studying God's word for information, because I love to learn new things, and you know I call myself the Bible nerd, love to learn new things, but what I love especially about what we're going to talk about tonight is that it's not just about information, but it's about how practical God's word is, even in our own culture today. Even though Moses wrote this book of Exodus, you know, thousands of years ago and lived in a completely different culture than we do, yet what we learn in this passage is as life-changing and as transformative as it was for the people that he wrote it for. And I think about when Peter talks about how the word of God is living and active. And God wasn't kidding when he said that, because what we're going to talk about tonight, we're going to see how living and active it truly is, because we're going to go, oh my goodness, that is exactly like today. It's the same thing as today. What we see when we dove into our homework this week is that the people of Israel had huge misconceptions about God. And the Egyptians had misconceptions about God. And Moses gives us a little insight into what some of those misconceptions were. Because back in Exodus 4:31, he wrote, God had visited his people and seen their affliction. Now that doesn't sound like really anything to us unless we really dive into it. But basically what Moses is telling us is that from their understanding, God physically came down and drew near in order to see what was happening to his people. So at this point, the Israelites, the people of God, do not understand this concept of God's omnipresence. They don't understand that God is everywhere all the time. And they don't understand the concept of God's omniscience, that he sees all and knows all the time. So what Moses is giving us an insight into here is that it so happened that at some particular time, God decided to come close, and when he did, then he saw. This is what he's alerting us to. Now, it's important that we understand this, because then when we read the rest of Exodus and we realize that the people don't really understand who God is completely, then some of the things that they do and some of the reactions that Moses has make a whole lot more sense. The second thing that we talked about this week in our homework is how every plague that God initiates, he does it specifically to prove that he is more powerful than the Egyptian gods. Every plague was a specific target to prove that he was more powerful than one of the gods of Egypt. Because at this time in the world, all of the major religions were polytheistic. They had a pantheon of gods, and all of the gods, sometimes they worked together, and sometimes they fought against each other, and one god could trick another god. If you've ever read any Greek mythology, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Same concept, same idea. And so God is trying to break through, and he's trying to get the people of Israel to realize he is the one true God. He is the only true God. All of these other deities are not also deities. They are false gods. They don't actually exist. There is one true God. His name is Yahweh. And this is what he is trying to get the people to understand. And so he says to Moses, he says, I am the Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. That's the word Yahweh. And he's saying, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but I did not reveal myself to them as capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. And so God is basically busting open their perceptions to say, I'm not just a God of power like all of these other false gods. I am the God who initiates relationship. This is the definition of Yahweh. I am the creator God, but I create relationship with my people. And so everything that God does and says is to make himself known and to contrast himself against the culture that the people live in. And he makes it clear that he's not just setting out for the people of Israel to know him. He says, I will reveal myself to Pharaoh and to the Egyptians. So we see God's global vision for all people to know him. He reveals it all the way back here in Exodus. And so we think about this whole idea of Yahweh, that he is this God of promise, that he is binding himself to his people. And we will see over and over Moses' great fear that God will abandon them. Why? Because he doesn't really understand who Yahweh is. And in his culture, the gods could change their minds. They weren't trustworthy. They would be happy with you in one moment and they would be displeased with you in another. And so it was this constant striving to try to figure out how to make the gods happy, how to please the gods so they wouldn't punish you, but so they would give you favor. And so Moses has, and the Israelites have, very limited understanding at this point of God's capability, that he's omniscient, he's omnipresent, he is over all, he is above all, and they also have misunderstanding about his character, that he is good and he is trustworthy and he is a God of relationship and covenant promise. Now we fast forward to the time of Jesus. Jesus has to battle culture. By the time Jesus comes on the scene, the people of Israel understand there is one God and one God only, right? The Lord is one. They understand this concept. They understand God's immense power and capability, but they still don't understand his character. They still are striving and doing all of these things to try to win God's favor. And now the false gods are still the same. They still are chasing after prosperity. They're still chasing after secret knowledge. The rabbis were the ones with the secret knowledge. They're still chasing after status, all these other false gods, security, intangible things, exactly like the Israelites were under Moses. And Jesus comes on the scene and he has to confront this culture. So what does Jesus teach in response to this culture of they understand that God is one and he's powerful, but they don't understand that he is good and he is kind and he is tender. So what does Jesus do? He teaches things like the parable of the Good Samaritan, the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the prodigal son. Why? Jesus is breaking through their culture, that your father is good, he is kind, he is full of love and mercy and compassion. Yes, he is all powerful. Yes, he is all holy, but he is also tender and he's intimate and he's concerned about your needs and he longs to meet them. And so this is the culture that Jesus comes in and he has to face. And he specifically chooses his teaching, one, to mirror Moses and the miracles that Moses does, but to confront the culture and their misconceptions about God. They still have this idea of God plus something else. God plus secret knowledge. The rabbis had special knowledge that not everyone else had. God plus works, God plus this, God plus that. So let's think about today. What is the culture that we are facing? What are the false ideas that our culture has about God, about Yahweh, about who He is? Just pause and just start to process that in your head. What are the things that we see invading believers' hearts and minds and causing them to misunderstand who Yahweh is and this gospel that we stand in? What is it? I see four things. I see science. I'm not anti-science, but we see this idea that science might be equal to or even elevated above faith. I see psychology. We'll dive in more into that. I still see this pursuit of status and wealth. And at the end, all of them go back to being tied to this concept of identity, of knowing who Yahweh is. All of His capability and all of His character and His sufficiency versus God plus something else. So Tammy, I want you to weigh in now. Which of those ones do you see or you want to speak to that you deal with in believers' lives that you see influencing them?
Okay, well, I see all of them for sure. But one of the ones I wanted to talk about is just the whole psychology side of things. And it ties so intricately, I believe, with our identity and also just with how we see God and really what the Israelites were dealing with. That is really the struggle, I think, that we see in our culture is, one, we want to try to figure ourselves out. And I think that by doing that, we think we'll figure out God. If we can figure out ourselves, we want to get into our own minds and think, why do we think this way? What can I figure out about me? And then we think if we can figure that out, then we can know God better, when we really know that the reverse is true, right? And yet how easily the enemy deceives us to just flip that around and let's just start focusing on ourselves, which is the easiest thing for all of us to do anyway, right? But if we get that wrong, we don't see God as we should, just as we see the Israelites having that same issue. And God being the all-powerful, almighty, limitless God that He is, that has all authority and all power, no matter what, over the whole universe, if we don't see it that way and see what He says about us to be true, then we aren't going to get ourselves right anyway. And I love Ephesians 1. It speaks so much to the identity that we have in Christ. And, you know, God says, I have all power. But He also said that Jesus had been given all authority. And He has now been elevated to the right hand of God, a place of honor, and that He will rule and reign. But what Jesus tells us in Ephesians, here's just a few, just to, you know, remember what and how God sees us. We are blessed. We are holy and blameless. And all of this is because God sees us through Jesus, and because of what Jesus has given us. But we're chosen by God. We're adopted into His family. We are redeemed. Our sins are forgiven. We're predestined for His purposes. We're sealed and marked by His Holy Spirit. We're guaranteed an inheritance. And He calls us saints. I mean, that's just a few. If you just go on in Ephesians, there's even more. But that is who we are. That is our identity. When we look in the mirror, how often do we think those things? But really, that is who we are. That is God made us in His image, and He gave all of this to us because we have taken on the righteousness of Christ. He gave us that. And so anyway, when we see ourselves that way, it completely changes how we view life and our actions and everything else that comes and flows out of that. And I believe then that it also helps us see the truth of who God is. And I feel like it reverses our motivation as well. Just as we can flip things around. To me, when we start to look at the psychology and try to figure ourselves out, I think that's rooted in really independence, the desire and even pride to, you know, be independent for God. If I can figure myself out, then I can make things happen and I'm in control and all of those things. When God says he wants us completely dependent on him, that is a humbling place to be, but that's exactly where he wants us. And so I think these things are subtle, but our culture can just influence to reverse things so easily, and then we get it wrong. And, you know, erring, even in the slightest bit of a degree, can get us all off, right? So I see that one as a big one that we can get wrong.
I see that too, and I think really it has to do with the starting point, right? Scripture says, listen, when you know God and you are pursuing him first, right? It talks about in the scripture how our lives are now hidden with Christ in God as believers. And when we are pursuing God and we are trying to understand more and more who God is, through that pursuit, through that process, we begin to understand ourselves. It's a byproduct. And not that psychology doesn't help us, but it's what is your starting point and what is your end goal? I've spent hours in a Christian counselor's office. I'm not bashing psychology at all, so I hope no one hears that. It's what is your starting point and what is your end goal? The start is Christ, the goal is Christ in me, the end is Christ through me. So I start with Christ, and I bring in some psychology, I bring in, you know, some personality tests, trying to figure out how I'm wired and all of these things. Where it becomes a problem is when we are so focused on, I want to know myself, and I'm not pursuing knowing my God. Start with pursuing knowing your God. And in the process, you will begin to know yourself. And when you begin to know yourself, you will know when you need to bring in that extra psychology to get some help to know God better and understand why you are doing the things that you are doing. But it always has to start with Christ. It always has to start with Christ, because psychology is a body of knowledge. Christ is the only one who can transform us. And we even saw this with Moses, right? Like, Moses is like, well, what about this? And what about this? And what about this? And what about this? And he's just blurting out all this nonsense that really has nothing to do with what's going on in his own heart. And what do we see God do? He steps in and he speaks to Moses about what's really going on in his heart that Moses couldn't even bring words to. Why? Because God knows our heart. He knows what needs healed. And he calls himself Jehovah Rapha, our healer. So we're not bashing psychology in any way, shape, or form. What my concern is when people are so focused on that without an equal and not even greater focus on pursuing the healer. And it's really tied into just this whole idea of knowledge, right? The priests of Pharaoh, they had all their secret magic arts, they had all their secret knowledge, right? And eventually it came to a point where they were like, well, now this is beyond us. We can't explain this. All we can say is this is the finger of God. Basically, they're saying this is unexplainable. We don't have an answer. And eventually that's what will happen with any of man's wisdom. It only goes so far. Only God is omniscient and his wisdom inexhaustible. But that whole pursuit of wisdom, we also see it in our culture in science. We see this strong elevation of science, and we see this wave in our culture that if you are a person of faith, you're not very intelligent. Right? There's this underlying of, you know, if you're just a person of faith, if you don't have a body of knowledge, if you can't empirically explain to me why you believe what you believe, you're silly and dumb and we shouldn't listen to you, right? But what I have found so interesting is lately in our culture, what we see is a whole slew of scientists who all disagree with one another. Have you noticed that lately? You turn into one news channel and they have the scientist who tells you one thing, and you tune into another news channel and you have a scientist who tells you a different thing, and the scientists don't even agree. Because why? It goes back to this whole idea. God is the one who holds infinite knowledge. There is no man who is going to have insight beyond the insight of God. There is no human who is going to hold the same amount of wisdom as the wisdom of our God. His wisdom is beyond all. And as we live in a culture where people are constantly wanting to degrade us, we have to just go back to what we know about God and what he reveals to himself. He is the Lord. He is the Most High. And scientists can say what scientists will say, and much of it will be true, and people devote their lives to science. I'm married to a doctor. But at the end of the day, only God holds authority over this universe. And scientists can make their best hypothesis and their best predictions, but every prophecy that is in the Word of God will come to pass. Because we learned that last week. God's a covenant God. He cannot lie. And what he says he will do, what he starts, he will finish. And so we live in a culture that wants to elevate knowledge. But we also live in a culture that wants to elevate status and wealth.
Yes, I think that's a very given for all of us. We see that everywhere around us. And I think that maybe out of all of them, they're all subtle, but it's really easy to just fall into this because those things kind of give us comfort, right? I mean, as we feel better about ourselves, whether we're comparing ourselves to others or it's just the material stuff, you know, we like comfort, we like things to be easy, we like, you know, it just kind of goes with our nature. And so I think that we see it pervading our culture, but it's also something that just appeals to us as human beings, I think, so easily. And it, obviously we see that all around us, I see the chasing after these things, the striving, and the Lord tells us to cease striving, but that in order to attain, whether it's material wealth or whether it is oftentimes the things are tied, but to be able to get that status, and many times you need the wealth and the power and the position and all of those things to get there. And all of that takes climbing and striving and intentionality pretty much to get there, right? And it's just something that I think is so interwoven into our culture that it's easy not even to notice when we're starting to get on that, I feel like, you know, the little rat trail or wheel, and we just keep going and going, and then it never ceases because it's insatiable, so we're just on it. And I just love that one of the verses that I've really kind of taken to heart, I put it in my prayer journal, because I think it's just so good. It says in Psalm 119:37, turn my eyes from worthless things. Preserve my life according to your word. If God can help us, which he promises he will, to turn our eyes, to turn our attention on the things that aren't worthless, that aren't going to burn up, they're not going to fade, they're going to be eternal. That's what I want to be about. And if we pray that prayer and we seek after him, we seek after the way he sees us and the way he sees the world and what he wants for us, we will be filled up. The other thing I really love is just this quote that God gives glory gifts. He's designed us to receive heavenly gifts, the things that will really fill us, the things that will really matter, like love and joy and peace and closeness to Him and the relationships that are God-given. Those are the things that fill us and that are lasting for eternity and that really matter. And that He's created us for those gifts, those things that come straight from Him, those glory gifts. And yet our culture just wants us to trade, you know, cheap, I think, exchanges for those things. And it's just real easy to get caught in that trap. So let's just keep on being focused on the really amazing gifts that only God can give.
I love that. I love the glory gifts. And at the end of the day, whether we're putting our faith in science, we're putting our faith in psychology, we're putting our faith in something to satisfy us, all of it is an act of faith. We're either going to put our faith in ultimately in God and what He says. You know, I was talking to a friend the other day, and I was talking to her about this whole idea of what I call leadership theology that's developing. And people will say things like, I'm adaptable on the strength finder, or I'm an Enneagram 7, and I love all of those tests. I think they're fascinating, and it trips me out how when you take them, there's such elements of them that can be so accurate. But you know what? At the end of the day, an Enneagram does not tell me who I am. And while an Enneagram might easily point out, hey, these are your strengths and these are your weaknesses and this is where you struggle and this is where you excel, God is able to transform me. He is able to transform my heart. If we put too much stock into things like that, you are essentially saying a test made up by human beings is what I am going to declare as my fate. I am this and I am no other. Well, no, you're a child of God. And so you are free to be molded and transformed and to grow and to learn new things and become better. And no, you are not fated into this list of weaknesses for the rest of your life. Your God is bigger than that. And so when we think about these things, I want all of us to just ask God for a thirst to know Him. Because at the end of the day, that is what this Exodus narrative is all about. God's desire for us to know Him and to understand Him in the fullness of all that He is. And as we relentlessly pursue that relationship with Him, He's like, listen, I am the God of relationship, and I am the God over everything, and I am the God who loves you infinitely, and I am the God of all power who can do anything and everything in your life. And as we pursue Him, as we have an insatiable thirst to pursue Him, His wonder-working power will do things in us and through us that a personality test would never even ask or think or imagine, right? That's what Scripture tells us. I have things planned for you beyond what you could even conceive, beyond what a personality test could ever predict over your life, is what the infinite, inexhaustible wisdom of God has. And so I want us to ask God to give us a thirst to know Him. And as we pursue that, to ask Him to reveal Himself to us and help us to understand who we are and who He has created us to be and who He desires us to become. Because as we do that, we are going to find a freedom to grow and become something way beyond anything man could ever wish for or hope for or desire for us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, it's so easy to chase after the wisdom of man. Because when we hear it from the voice of another human, it seems so much more certain than to hear it in the whisper of our heart from you. But Jesus, your words to us only bring life and only bring healing. And man is just another flawed creature. And so, Jesus, while we seek the wisdom of man for areas of healing in our life, and it is appropriate to do so at certain times, I pray as believers we would be as eager and as ready and as committed to seeking you and hearing your voice and allowing you to speak to us through your word as we are about seeking the wisdom of another human. And Jesus, what you reveal to us in your word is that you came to heal us and you came to change us. You came to renew our mind. You came to restore our soul. You came to heal our heart. This is who you are. And so may we ever pursue you to do those things in our lives, because you are the Lord, the God Most High, with wisdom over all. In Jesus' name, amen.